Cara Sherry, muito obrigado por se juntar a nós e a todos os que decidiram tirar um pedaço do final das vossas tardes para refletirmos em conjunto sobre o populismo e as respostas de esquerda a este fenómeno. O populismo é de facto um fenómeno perigoso que corrói as democracias e talvez tão antigo como as próprias democracias. Aliás, alimenta-se do elemento mais marcante e talvez no fim das contas mais positivo das próprias democracias, que é o poder do voto popular. Julgo que existem dois tipos de populistas. Aqueles que sempre tiveram esse tipo de posições e que ciclicamente vão tendo mais ou menos apoio popular e eleitoral conforme um conjunto de condições económicas e sociais a que já me referirei. Ou aqueles que são simplesmente oportunisticamente populistas. Julgo que são, aliás, a maioria, e que defendem ocasionalmente esse tipo de posições quando consideram que elas serão melhor recebidas. É o caso de alguma extrema-direita, que, por exemplo, e nos últimos anos saiu dos buracos onde se escondeu no passado. É o caso de alguns que tinham posições políticas diferentes e que migraram para o populismo, por mero oportunismo, como referi há pouco. Ou o caso mesmo de alguns partidos de mainstream que incorporaram nos seus discursos parte do discurso populista, o que é particularmente perigoso, pois normaliza o populismo. Alguns exemplos que me parecem bastante evidentes. No âmbito do PPE, a nível europeu, há um partido que esteve pelo menos 8 anos a ser tolerado, sem que nada de especial acontecesse, o Fidesz, de Viktor Orban, no âmbito do PPE. Com posições que, para além também de serem posições de grave atentado ao Estado de Direito ou até anti-europeias, foram também posições de ataque aos refugiados e às minorias. Ainda bem recentemente, quando o Fidesz decidiu atacar Jean-Claude Juncker, como é que decidiu fazer esse ataque? Associando a Jorge Soros, que é um homem que, além de ser muito rico, é também judeu, e portanto foi esse o tipo de críticas que o Fidesz escolheu para fazer naquele momento. Em Portugal, temos resistido a esta tendência bastante, mas mesmo assim vemos alguns dos partidos, eu diria institucionais, a esboçarem tendências perigosas, como que a testar o terreno às vezes. Ainda há poucos dias ouvimos o eurodeputado Nuno Melo a defender a liberalização do acesso às armas, ou com um discurso bem perigoso sobre as migrações. Na direita europeia há exemplos evidentes de como se procura, como se acaba por normalizar o populismo. E até a extrema-direita, em alguns casos, com exemplos que vão desde a governação na Áustria, até à Itália, ou até ao que se passa aqui ao lado na vizinha Espanha, quer com a formação de governo na Andaluzia com o apoio do Vox, como com a normalização através das fotografias de família da direita espanhola feitas pelo Pablo Casado. De facto, esta tendência tem vindo a acentuar-se. E como eu referi no início, do meu ponto de vista, isso acontece na justa medida em que alguns destes partidos, alguns destes atores políticos, por oportunismo, entendem que o discurso populista vai encontrar acolhimento junto à população naquele tempo. Porque é que as pessoas se tornam permeáveis aos discursos populistas? Bem, do meu ponto de vista, esse processo desenvolve-se sempre que se verifica uma maior vulnerabilidade de alguns grupos sociais. Essa vulnerabilidade normalmente ocorre quando os grupos sociais, com um determinado grupo social, sentem uma ameaça à sua identidade enquanto grupo ou à sua segurança. E, quando digo segurança, estou a falar sobretudo, neste caso agora, de segurança económica, por exemplo. A palavra-chave é sempre a ameaça ou o medo. Na maior parte dos casos, o sentimento de ameaça corresponde a uma realidade concreta da vida das pessoas, noutros casos, tem a ver com realidades percepcionadas. Se repararmos na situação europeia, por exemplo, e podemos olhar para ela num espaço de tempo bastante largo, mas olhar em particular no período a partir da crise financeira e de lá para cá, vejamos como a evolução dos rendimentos, mesmo nos países mais ricos, correspondeu ao aumento das desigualdades. E essas desigualdades acentuaram-se na sequência da crise financeira, mas já existiam, de facto, até antes da crise financeira. Aliás, num certo sentido, as desigualdades no quadro europeu foram causa da própria crise financeira E já se verificava que mesmo nos países mais ricos do centro da Europa, as desigualdades tinham aumentado e não regredido no período antes da crise financeira. As classes médias e as classes mais desfavorecidas percepcionaram e viveram, de facto, um aumento das desigualdades e insegurança económica. Esse abandono das classes médias e dos mais desfavorecidos acabou por ser um pasto para a progressão dos populismos. Apelando ao medo, a uma resposta tribal às ameaças, os populismos desencadearam reações simplistas, sem densidade, mas com grande apelo às massas. O artifício é sempre o mesmo: identificar os grupos que se sentem excluídos ou ameaçados, a causa dessa ameaça, e depois instigar o sentimento de medo. Utilizar mecanismos primitivos, como a agressividade contra os outros, que são sempre causas que identificam para estas ameaças. Todos estes grupos podem ser identificados nas ameaças à identidade ou à condição económica do grupo de referência. Todos estes fenómenos são os maus que ameaçam os bons, num modo de pensamento bastante simplista, mas que infelizmente e por vezes é inerente à condição humana, sobretudo aqueles que se sentem em situação de fragilidade, e os populistas aproveitam-se de facto disso. A esquerda tem algumas possibilidades de responder a este fenómeno de crescimento do populismo. Bom, a esquerda pode, desde logo, elevar a democracia. Infelizmente, na campanha que agora começou para as eleições europeias, tenho muita pena dizer que este é um exemplo de uma campanha que instiga os populismos. Lamento que, de facto, isso tenha acontecido. Estamos habituados a campanhas com falsidades, com calúnias em relação aos adversários. Não esperávamos, talvez, que esta campanha fosse de uma forma tão evidente de apelo aos populismos com este tempo mais recente, estas campanhas dos conflitos de interesses, das famílias, etc., que, de facto, acabam sempre, como eu, aliás, tinha dito assim que isto começou, isto acabaria sempre mal, com os partidos, numa espécie de concorrência uns contra os outros relativamente a este tema, a sujar, de facto, no fim das contas, a democracia. E eu lamento que assim seja, e lamento que a direita tenha começado, ou tenha trazido para a campanha das europeias, este tipo de temas tão perigosos. Mas julgo que, finalmente, a grande questão, para além de elevarmos, de facto, a democracia, é, no fim das contas, o modo como governamos. A maior resposta que a esquerda pode dar, ou que os partidos, que, de facto, não são partidos populistas, podem dar a este tipo de tendências, de apelos, é a forma como se governa e como se governa para as pessoas. E há muito tempo, penso, e como sabem, fui um ator, eu diria, envolvido e conhecedor da resposta de governos nacionais, mas também das instituições europeias, a esta crise financeira e das dívidas soberanas, e dizia de há muito tempo, penso, que no fim das contas os populismos encontram pasto sempre que as democracias deixam de governar, resolvendo e melhorando a vida das pessoas, e em particular das classes médias. Durante cerca de uma década foi o que aconteceu. Sucederam-se os governos e a situação das classes médias e nos países foi sempre piorando. E ainda por cima, isso sucede-se a um período, que foi o período desde a criação do euro, onde, de facto, também tinham aumentado as desigualdades no espaço da zona euro e na Europa. E por isso é preciso regressar ao tempo em que se governava para as pessoas. E esse é o tempo daquele grande pacto das democracias, e em particular aqui na nossa Europa, das instituições europeias com as classes médias. Esse pacto, para mim, chamou-se modelo social europeu. Nós lá atrás fizemos uma construção de paz, uma construção de desenvolvimento económico e que, aproximar os países, de facto, contribuía para a paz, mas sabíamos desde o início que precisávamos de equilíbrios sociais, de convergência e de coesão. E por isso construímos o modelo social europeu. E enquanto o modelo social europeu teve força, a Europa prosperou, mas também a Europa, sendo mais coesa, não deu pasto, não deu espaço a estes populismos. Quando, por alturas da criação do euro e de um conjunto de reformas, de desregulação económica, social e laboral, algumas delas, e não das menos importantes, até foram lideradas por alguns governos social-democratas na Europa, dizia, quando se cedeu a essa ideia de que, para sermos mais competitivos no mundo, a Europa ser mais competitiva no mundo, precisava de desregular e de fazer este caminho, demos de facto espaço a que crescessem estes populismos. E por isso é preciso regressar a essa governação e esse pacto com as classes médias. Nós, no contexto das eleições europeias, chamámos-lhe, simplificando, um novo contrato social para a Europa. Mas, de facto, o que queremos fazer, julgo que está muito próximo daquilo que foi a governação no nosso país nos últimos anos. Políticas de investimento para se criar mais emprego, políticas de redução da pobreza e das desigualdades, que são as políticas que, no fim das contas, aproximarão mais a governação das classes médias e contribuirão, de facto, julgo eu, para resgatar o espaço das democracias junto das populações. E também, certamente, do projeto europeu. É aquilo que tenho a expectativa que a Europa faça no futuro, é aquilo em que acredito e que julgo que a Europa deve fazer no futuro, recriar esses projetos de investimento com promoção efetiva de convergência e implementar aquilo que foi aprovado há pouco tempo, mas ainda no campo dos princípios, o pilar europeu dos direitos sociais. Se formos capazes de regressar a uma governação com resultados efetivos para as classes médias e para a redução das desigualdades, estou certo que os populismos crescerão menos no espaço europeu nos próximos anos. Acredito que a reflexão da Sherry será, para nós, muito importante nesta tarde, neste final de tarde, deixarmos-á certamente algumas pistas de como avalia o modo como a esquerda europeia, a social-democracia, o trabalhismo, respondeu, de facto, nos últimos anos, à evolução económica e social no mundo e na Europa, e certamente poderá também contribuir para a nossa reflexão sobre o modo como devemos agir a partir daqui, as lições que temos que retirar do que aconteceu nos últimos anos para, neste momento decisivo para o projeto europeu, construirmos uma resposta que seja, de facto, uma resposta progressista, europeísta e que combate eficazmente os populismos. Por isso, Sherry, é uma grande satisfação tê-la connosco e espero, naturalmente, que daqui saiamos mais robustecidos no nosso pensamento para prepararmos a nossa ação na Europa, mas também aqui em Portugal. Muito obrigado a todos. Sherry Burman, a palavra é sua.
Thank you very much. I'm very happy and honored to be here. I was told that I should say at the outset that should anyone have any questions, I'm more than happy to take them. And Maria has graciously offered to translate any questions should you prefer to ask them in Portuguese. So thank you for coming and for spending some of your early evening with me. Hopefully I will make it worth your while. So European democracies, as I'm sure all of you are aware, are going through some of their most difficult times, if not since the 1960s, then perhaps even since the end of the Second World War. So here are some slides to start you off by getting you a little depressed. These are numbers, for instance, on democratic dissatisfaction in different European countries. So as you can see, in particular, dissatisfaction with democratic performance, that second column, is really quite high. So the difference between the first is the first are people who are dissatisfied with democracy as a system. The second is people who are dissatisfied with the way democracy is working. And those numbers are really quite startlingly high, even here, actually, in Portugal. And as we already heard, and as I'm sure you are all aware, the most obvious manifestation of this dissatisfaction is the rise of populist parties in various parts of Europe. Populist parties in general, but more specifically, populist parties on the right. Now, there are lots of explanations for why we have seen both increasing dissatisfaction with democracy and the rise of populism. So I would say that there are three main explanations for this phenomenon: economic, social, and technology. So the first type of explanation, the one that is most common, I think, focuses on economic trends. So this is a famous graph by a well-known economist named Branko Milanović, and it basically shows what has happened to the gains of economic growth over the past generation. So it's called an elephant curve because maybe you can see it. It sort of looks a little bit like an elephant's trunk. So what does this graph show you? This graph shows you that disproportionately, the gains from economic growth over the past generation have basically gone to two groups. One is the poor and middle classes in developing countries. So we know this story about places like China, for instance. Dramatic, really impressive increases in wealth that have driven hundreds of millions of people out of poverty. So there you really have seen tremendous economic gains. But the other place the gains have gone in the already advanced industrial world is to the already wealthy. So gains to the poor and middle classes in the developing world, but gains primarily to the already wealthy in the West. Now, why is this relevant for dissatisfaction and populism? Because it purportedly explains a lot of things. It explains increasing resentment of developing countries in some parts of the West, like my own country, the United States. And it also explains growing divisions within Western societies as, again, the poor and the middle classes have not benefited as much from economic growth as they have in the past. So in this view, right, dissatisfaction with democracy and populism is primarily driven by folks who are the losers of globalization, people with low education, members of the working class, those who are sort of facing, you know, a new world that they are not able to compete in. And again, geographically, we've seen incredible divides in many Western societies, in my own country, France, Germany, other places, in areas, again, that are sort of left behind by globalization. And so these are the folks in this view who are driving populism. That's one view. The other view is that actually this dissatisfaction and populism is driven not primarily by economic trends, but rather by social and cultural trends. And in Europe, of course, this is particularly discussed as a backlash to immigration. So the idea here is that people who are dissatisfied with democracy and who are tending to vote for populism, these are people who are very worried about changes in their societies, and in particular about demographic change. They don't like immigrants. They don't like people who are different from them. And so in this view, again, this is a story about nativist backlash, and populists in this view are basically racists and xenophobes, et cetera, et cetera. The third type of explanation focuses on technology and social media. Again, I'm sure folks are fairly familiar with this view. Here, again, the mechanism has to do with changes in the way we communicate. So the idea here is that, again, by allowing the spread of fake news, by allowing people to isolate themselves in communities where only like-minded people speak to each other, by an inability for us to sort of generate common narratives as we would have been able to more easily in some places during the post-war period, and also, of course, by facilitating meddling by interlopers like the Russians, that this is really, again, an important cause behind the rise of populism and dissatisfaction with democracy. So these explanations are the most common and obviously have some validity. But I actually want to talk about something else today, another cause that I think is also very important in explaining democratic dissatisfaction and the rise of populism, and that is the decline of the center-left or social democracy. Now, let me preface this by saying I am very aware that this terminology here in Portugal is quite confusing, because frustratingly, your Social Democratic Party is not a party of the center-left, it's a party of the center-right. So forgive the terminology, it broadly fits the rest of Europe. But when I talk about social democracy, what I mean is the center-left. So here, this would be more your socialist than your Social Democratic Party. And notice Portugal is included here, even though, again, the name is sort of incorrect. So I want to talk about the connection between the decline of the center-left in much of Europe and declining satisfaction with democracy and the rise of populism. Now, this, again, is a story, I'm guessing, for most of you who are here, that is an unfortunately familiar one, right? Those lines are all going more or less in the same direction. So the French and the Dutch socialist parties, for example, almost disappeared in their last national elections. The SPD, the German Social Democratic Party, the great SPD, right? The sort of core founder in many ways of the modern socialist movement. This party was obviously eviscerated in the last election and is now not even the main opposition party by polling numbers in Germany anymore. Even in Scandinavia, which has sort of been the home of the most successful social democratic parties in Europe, these parties are now fighting to maintain 30% of the vote, which is an incredible decline from their historic highs. Again, Portugal is an exception here. I will come back to it a little bit at the end. If possible, the situation in Eastern Europe is even grimmer. We there have had, again, the sort of center-left or social democratic alternatives eviscerated over the last years. They barely even exist as a political option in Eastern Europe anymore. And this trend is not, by the way, limited to Europe, East or West. We also can see this in parts of Latin America as well. So, question, why have we seen the decline of the center-left across Europe and in other parts of the world? And how is that decline linked to these broader trends? Well, what I want to argue today is that, again, just as there's lots of reasons for the rise of populism, there are lots of reasons why the center-left has had problems over the past decades. But I think one really needs to be prioritized, and that one is the embrace by much of the left during the end of the 20th century of neoliberal, pro-market types of economic policies. What I'm going to argue is that although these policies made a lot of sense in the short term, that over the long term, this shift to the center economically on the part of the social democratic or center left had very, very serious, perhaps even deadly consequences. First, it robbed the left of its historic profile, what its core identity was. It also made center-left or social democratic parties unable, as we heard before, to capture some of the resentment and anger that came particularly with the fallout from the financial crisis. And I'm also going to argue that this shift helped open up a space, create a political opportunity for the nativist populist right in much of Europe, and thereby contributed to some of the broader problems facing democracy in Europe. All right, so in order to argue this, I'm going to ask you to indulge me in a little history. I'm going to go back a little bit to some of the origins of the left, partially because I find it interesting, but also because I think it links to some of the things that are going on today. So capitalism, or rather a backlash to capitalism, is the whole reason the modern left exists. So capitalism emerges in Europe in the late 18th and 19th century, and it brings unprecedented economic growth and unprecedented personal freedoms. But it also, of course, brings dramatic inequality, economic inequality, new types of insecurity to European societies, and of course, immense social and cultural disruption. And in response to these things, we get the rise of an international socialist movement with Marxism as its kind of ideological lodestar. However, this movement fractures during the late 19th century over how to actually deal with capitalism's development. Unlike what Marx had confidently told socialists, capitalism by the late 19th century is not, in fact, collapsing. Indeed, during the late 19th century, it undergoes a period of renewed vigor as a new type of capitalism, a globalized capitalism, actually begins spreading across the globe during the late 19th century. And in response to this changing nature of capitalism, the left splinters into three groups, essentially. So, first group becomes communists. These folks argue that if history is not going to deliver the sort of utopia that Marx promised, if capitalism is not going to collapse on its own, then the alternative, that the left should embrace is that it should itself destroy capitalism through the efforts of a revolutionary vanguard. So this is the communist solution to the problem that capitalism was not going to collapse as Marx had predicted. That's one option. Second option, and this becomes what I call, again, you can use whatever terms are comfortable for you, because obviously they're a little random in the Portuguese setting. Another group of socialists said, okay, capitalism is not collapsing as quickly as Marx had predicted, but it's so terrible, its internal contradictions are so great, that it will eventually collapse. And so it is the job of the left to kind of tell people about this coming terrible collapse and sort of prepare them for the day when that will inevitably happen. But they were unwilling, like the communists were, to embrace violence, and they insisted on sticking within a democratic framework. So these folks, Karl Kautsky is the kind of key theoretician of this view, these folks become what could be thought of as democratic socialists. But then there's a third group. This group took from the development of capitalism the idea that, well, maybe actually Marx was wrong. Maybe actually capitalism is not going to collapse at any point in the near future. And therefore, it was the job of the left to use the powers of democracy to harness the incredible productive powers of capitalism and to use those incredible productive powers for progressive ends. These were the people who thought you could have the upsides of capitalism, the incredible economic growth, without the downsides, because the democratic state could manage those things. These people became social democrats, and Edward Bernstein was their foremost theoretician during the late 19th and early 20th century. Now, up through the interwar years, these three different groups sort of struggle with each other to dominate the left, and they struggle with other groups, fascists, liberals, national socialists, for domination in Europe more generally. However, except for a very brief communist interlude in Hungary and social democratic success in Scandinavia during the 1930s, none of these groups kind of succeed in dominating Europe during up through the interwar period. Now, of course, this all changes after 1945. After 1945, Eastern Europe, of course, ends up under communist domination. And interestingly, Western Europe ends up dominated by a social democratic ideology, even though social democratic parties are not in power in all European countries. So after 1945, having lived through the Great Depression, having lived through the Second World War, you see growing support after 1945 for a new type of order to be reconstructed in Western Europe. After 1945, you get actors across the political spectrum, not just on the left, but also on the center-right, Christian Democratic parties and other types of sort of center-right parties, that basically understand that if democracy is going to succeed in Western Europe after 1945, if Western Europe is not going to face the same challenges that it did during the interwar years, extremism on the left and right, growing potential crises coming from capitalist disorder, that Western Europe has to rebuild again in a new way after 1945, that democratic states have to be able to protect their citizens from capitalism's destructive economic and social consequences. This meant that government would have to be a different kind of government than it was before 1945. Democratic governments had to commit themselves to being guardians of society, promoters of social stability, and not just economic night watchmen. So what you get after 1945 in Western Europe is something that's dramatically different from what you had before 1945. So you still had capitalism. This went against what communists had preferred. Obviously, they would have preferred for capitalism to disappear. But it's a capitalism of a very different type than existed before the war. It is tempered and limited by the role of democratic governments. And this is, of course, a big contrast to what classical liberals had preferred, which was obviously a capitalism that was as free from government interference as possible. But this mix, a capitalist system, but one that was kind of reined in by democratic governments, this was, of course, precisely what social democrats had been advocating since the late 19th century. But it took the tragedies of the 30s and 40s to get a broader agreement on the efficacy, the desirability of this particular type of model. So again, as I'm sure you're all aware, we have 30 years in Western Europe that are incredibly successful after 1945. They are incredibly successful economically and politically. So the 30 years after 1945 are Western Europe's fastest period of growth ever. Never had growth like that before, and haven't, unfortunately, had growth like that since. But perhaps even more unusual was that you got successful democratic consolidation in Western Europe after 1945, built on the foundations of the social democratic compromise. Now, it's important to recognize that consolidated democracy was not the norm in Western Europe before 1945. So again, living in Southern Europe or Eastern Europe, democracy in Western Europe may seem long-lived. But before 1945, successful democracy was the exception. It was not the rule. And it's only after 1945 that democracy becomes kind of taken for granted in Western Europe, and it was only able to do so built on this social democratic foundation. Now, despite this success, politically and economically, this social democratic consensus begins to fray by the 1970s and early 1980s. On the left, many began to forget that many of the reforms that were part of this social democratic compromise were means to an end. The reforms were not the goal, the end of controlling capitalism and making it work with democracy, that was the goal. And a lot of people began to forget that and began on the left to be instead just comfortable with a sort of technocratic managing and devoted thinking about the way capitalism was developing and how the left would have to deal with changes in capitalism. The consequence was that during the last decades of the 20th century, the left did not devote a lot of intellectual energy or strategic thought to thinking about how capitalism was changing and what might need to be done differently as a result of that. And the consequences of this, again, become clear by the late 70s and the early 1980s, when Europe and the United States runs into a huge set of economic problems. We get a kind of noxious mix of inflation and unemployment, get a whole new term for it, stagflation, that really seems to, again, knock the economic foundations out from under this order. Now, during the previous decades, a neoliberal right had been thinking very carefully about what it saw as the downsides of this post-war social democratic compromise. And it was therefore ready by the late 1970s and early 1980s with explanations for this economic crisis and with solutions for it in a way that the left was not. So with the right having these ideas already there, and the left not having a coherent, credible alternative to put forward, the neoliberal right begins to gain dominance over economic discourse and policymaking during this time, and freeing markets from many of the restrictions that had been put on them during the 30 years after 1945. And so what we get, ironically, is a dramatic reversal of what happens after 1945. So as I said, after 1945, we kind of get a general consensus both on the left and on the traditional right, reaction or as a recognition to the problems of the interwar years. So you get this kind of consensus-like view after 1945. But by the early 1980s, we get another consensus with both, again, the center-left and the center-right now also agreeing, but agreeing on something very different. That is to say, agreeing on this new set of neoliberal ideas. Now, given the left's history, this shift away from this kind of social democratic sensibility, away from an understanding of capitalism as potentially incredibly productive, but also potentially incredibly dangerous, this is really quite remarkable. Again, totally goes against what the entire history of the left has been built upon. Now, this this shift goes across, again, the left. We all know, again, the exemplars of this shift, Tony Blair's New Labor, Gerhard Schroeder's SPD, in my own country, Clinton's New Democrats. Now, I don't want to suggest, with the benefit of hindsight, right, it's always easy to condemn retrospectively, this shift made sense to many on the left at the time. Not only did the left not have its own alternative view, but almost every mainstream economist at the time pushed this, right? So again, we have the famous, or now at this point infamous, quote by Tony Blair about, it was about as useful to debate globalization as it was to debate whether autumn should follow summer. Now this is a really, really critical statement, right? Because it basically says that the left and democratic governments more generally can't do anything major fundamentally about economic development. That really goes against everything that the left had stood for during the post-war period. Said that democratic governments not only could, but needed to do these kinds of things, right? Paul Krugman, Nobel Prize winner, incredibly influential American economist, similar kinds of ideas. Obviously, only stupid people think that this is bad. Now, I should note that he has changed his mind since then and has become very cognizant of the downsides of globalized capitalism and how politically dangerous it is. But during the late 20th century, this was the mainstream view. Tom Friedman, again, a very famous writer and columnist in my own country, sort of characterized globalization at the time as a golden straitjacket, which is what you sort of put on crazy people. You sort of wrap them up. The idea being that once you were in it, really there was, you had very little wiggle room. There was just not that much that democratic governments could do. Now, again, this made sense in the short term, with the left not having an alternative and everybody else saying these things. I'm not, it's easy to condemn Blair and Clinton and Schroeder, but this was what happened. Now, again, this had really dramatic consequences, this shift. As I mentioned, first, it implied a remarkable transformation of the left's longstanding appeal and even identity. Again, the modern left was a product of the backlash against capitalism, a product of a recognition of how dangerous capitalism could be. And Western Europe's success after 1945 was predicated on an assertion that democratic governments could give us the best of all worlds. They could have growth, but protect us from capitalism's downsides. You could have growth and equality, so to speak. This was the promise. Now, once the left switched to this neoliberal view, what happens when the inevitable fallout comes? And it always comes, right? Capitalism is wonderful, but as we know, it has these potential downsides. And so particularly when we began to see things during the late 20th and early 21st century, like, again, growing inequality, like the gains of growth going disproportionately to the already privileged, what did this mean? This meant that the traditional left was no longer in a position to capture the resentment and anger generated by these economic trends. This, of course, becomes even clearer when the financial crisis hits, when many of these trends are aggravated, and of course, in many countries like Portugal, austerity measures were imposed on populations, hurting the most vulnerable most of all. and increasing the sense, therefore, among many, that to blame for their problems and the problems of their society more generally. So with the traditional left no longer able to capture the resentment and anger from these economic trends, an opportunity arose for another set of parties to do so, and these parties turned out to be populist parties. Now, in some countries, you got populist parties on the far left arising. Podemos in Spain and Mélenchon's party in France. But much, much more common was a dramatic reorientation of the populist right. Now, populist rights, as you may the populist right, as you may remember from the first slide, these parties had begun in many countries in the 1980s. But they increased their vote share dramatically, particularly after the financial crisis. And some start even earlier. So what do you see? Let's take the classic, the oldest one, the National Front in France. Now, under Marine Le Pen's father, this party began as a party that embraced very conservative economic policies. They favored a smaller state, they favored fewer taxes, they favored welfare state cutbacks. By the time Marine Le Pen comes around, this party had shifted dramatically to the left economically, supporting a type of welfare chauvinism. Exactly the same pattern in Austria. The Freedom Party had been around for a long time. It started out as a party of neo-Nazis and economic liberals. By the early 21st century, it too has shifted to the left economically, embracing a form of welfare chauvinism. In Denmark, the first populist party of the right was the anti-statist, anti-tax progress party. Some of you may be old enough to remember that one. By, again, the late 20th, early 21st century, that economically liberal party was gone, replaced by the pro-welfare state right-wing populist Danish People's Party. In Germany, more recently, the AfD, as some of you are probably aware, starts off as a party of middle-class intellectuals and professionals opposed to the European Union and opposed to bailouts of southern European countries. But during the last election, it too moves to the left economically and embraces a form of welfare state chauvinism. That is to say, social spending, more state, but only for native Germans. UKIP in Britain also, same kind of thing, starts off on the right economically, moves to the left during more recent elections. During the last election in Sweden, again, social democracy's home turf, the populist right-wing Sweden Democrats proclaim that they, and not the Social Democrats, are the true protectors of the Swedish welfare state. So, in addition to providing populists with an opportunity to champion growing economic discontent, I think the acceptance by the traditional center-left of pro-market neoliberal policies also contributed in many Western societies to the growing power of social and cultural issues. As the left and the right converge economically, there are great incentives for party leaders to emphasize non-economic issues. If you have nothing distinctive to offer economically, then it makes much more sense to focus on places where you can offer some kind of difference. And so, as the traditional left and right sort of, again, move to the center, you have party leaders emphasizing social and cultural trends. So think about how many parties in the left, how many left parties in Western Europe begin defining the left as standing for, again, an embrace of immigration, an embrace of increased protection for minorities, all things that I'm sure we all agree with, but this became the sort of defining thing for the left rather than economic issues. It also made sense, of course, as the left and the right converged economically, for voters to pay more attention to social and cultural issues because there wasn't all that much differentiating the left and right on economic issues. Now, this shift to the embrace of social and cultural issues, to the prioritization of social and cultural issues, this obviously occurs also on the right. This is what the populist right feeds off. But it's important for people on the left to recognize that generally, these are not winning issues for the left. Not because they're not important issues, but because the right has a real advantage in talking about them. The left's constituencies are in general much more divided on social and cultural issues than the right's are, right? We have new left voters and old left voters. We have voters who are native born. We have voters who have immigrant backgrounds. And so focusing on these issues tends to splinter the left's constituency more than it tends to splinter the right's constituency. And historically, moreover, the left has always done better when class identities are at the forefront, and when people are voting, at least in the past, based on their economic interests. Okay, so let me talk a little bit now, since I think I've been going on for a while, to sum up some of these arguments. So I think the decline of the center left or social democratic left is one of the most striking and consequential trends of the last decades. Now, again, there are many reasons for that. I'm not trying to oversimplify. But I think that this shift to the center on economic issues should be prioritized among the many things that have been going on. And I think it should be prioritized, again, for a number of reasons. First, I don't think this was just a shift in policy. I think this was a shift in principles. Indeed, even perhaps a shift in the left's long-standing identity, in the way the left was thought of in Europe in particular. And so, particularly once the negative consequences of neoliberalism began to be felt, and even more with the fallout from the financial crisis and austerity, as the fallout from these things became clear, this meant, since the left's economic profile had become so watered down, that many voters began to think, well, why should I vote for the left at all? In addition, I think prioritizing the left's shift to the center economically also helps us understand why it has been declining in Western Europe, in Eastern Europe, and also in other parts of the world. So if we look, for instance, this is just about economic and social issues. If we look, for instance, at Latin America, there's some evidence even here that when the left shifts sort of towards the center or towards neoliberalism economically, that this, even in Latin America, obviously a very different context, that this also was one of the most important factors opening up a space for a populist right. So Kenneth Roberts, who's a scholar of Latin American politics, among others, has made this argument. He argued that when neoliberal reforms were adopted in a kind of, what we say in English, bait and switch, right? So the left sort of comes to power saying, we are the left, we will protect you, and then it comes to power and puts in place these reforms, that this really robs the left of its ability to kind of appeal to many of its traditional constituents and is a key factor in opening up a space for more populist alternatives. Okay, so this leads again to another important point that I've stressed, which is I think that this center shift by the left also is a key factor behind the rise of populism. In Western Europe and in Eastern Europe, as well as other parts of the world, populists took advantage of the political and economic space opened up by the left's acceptance of pro-market neoliberal policies. Again, as I said, very striking in Western Europe, almost every one of these populist right-wing parties, France, Austria, Germany, Britain, Sweden, all of them started off economically liberal and moved to the left over the course, particularly of the early 21st century. very much again with the incentives that were created by the left and the center left and the center right converging on this central, this centrist neoliberal consensus. In Eastern Europe as well, which I didn't talk as much about because I was afraid I was going on for too long, you also got populists very much arising to take advantage of the negative fallout from Eastern Europe's transition to democracy. So very much you see these populist parties in Eastern Europe trying to appeal to those who feel like they have been left behind by the transition, who have not benefited quite as much as the cosmopolitan city dwellers. Very much same kind of appeal to what should be, or at least historically was, the left's traditional constituencies, workers, lower middle class voters, things like that. I also think this economic shift is important because I think it's very hard to explain the growing salience of social and cultural issues without paying attention to this centrist economic shift. I think that as soon as the left and right begin to converge on these sort of similar economic policies, there is an incredible incentive created for politicians to emphasize other kinds of issues instead, social and cultural issues that allow them to differentiate themselves better from their competitors. But once you shift the main axis of political competition to social and cultural issues from economic issues, the left is at a disadvantage. Historically, of course, the left always does better when class identities are strong and economic grievances are at the forefront of the debate. And, of course, the left is more divided than the right on these issues. Populist right parties tend to be actually, interestingly enough, very divided in some ways. In many parts of Western Europe, they are composed largely of working and lower middle class voters. And what those people agree upon with other voters are social and cultural issues, right? What the left's voters tend to agree upon is not social and cultural issues as much. Those are issues that fracture the left but unify the populist right. So when competition shifts to that axis, the left is at, I think, a structural disadvantage. And I think the growing prominence of social and cultural issues is not only an important part of why the populist right has done so well. I think it also actually relates to some of the broader problems facing democracy more generally in Europe as well as other parts of the world. Social and cultural issues, more so even than economic issues, they touch obviously on questions of identity. And they therefore have a tendency to be sort of either or zero-sum kinds of questions, right? They're more difficult to compromise on, they're more difficult to bargain over, and this is what democracy is all about. Democracy is about compromise and bargaining. But when people feel their identities are threatened, it becomes much more difficult to engage in that kind of bargaining and compromises. Questions about economic resources, at least in theory, on the other hand, right, are kind of more or less kinds of questions, sooner or later kinds of questions. They're much more amenable to compromise and bargaining than are questions that touch on people's identities. Okay, so this brings me back to the question about the decline of the left and democracy more generally. So during the post-war period, people who felt left behind could find a champion in social democratic or center-left parties. But these parties were committed to the democratic rules of the game. They were democratic, and they were liberal in the small L. That is to say, they were committed to the rule of law, individual rights, minority rights. They were committed to liberal democracy. But during the late 20th century, these social democratic or center-left parties began to lose the ability to play this role. That is to say, to be the natural home or champion of people who felt left behind, who felt disadvantaged, who felt like the system wasn't working for them. One of the most important roles parties play in democracy is representative. They give citizens an institutionalized voice. But if traditional parties are no longer giving voice to a significant sector of the population, voters who begin to feel like their interests, their needs, their demands, and their grievances are not being given a voice are going to look for other parties to give them a voice. And those parties may not be parties that are as committed to democracy, to liberal democracy, as liberal, as social democratic and center-left parties have been. There is a reason why populists, regardless of their context, always have some common things in their appeal. And one of the most common is voice. We are the voice of the common people who have been left behind. I hear this all the time in the United States now from Donald Trump. Very common, again, across the populist world. It's very difficult to understand the appeal of I am your voice, we are your voice, without understanding, again, how many people feel like they lost a voice. And so we're looking for someone or something else to give them that voice. So I think it's very difficult, if not impossible, to decouple democracy's current malaise, dissatisfaction with democracy, from a crisis of representation. That is to say, from a crisis of too many people feeling that they had lost a voice. And it's difficult to decouple this feeling by many people that they had lost their voice from the decline of the center or social democratic left. So I'd like to end a little bit with some potential positives. I think that it is very, very important for the left to be able to once again offer a distinctive economic alternative. This is what the left is all about. Telling people that there is no alternative, this is not something you want to tell people, especially on the left, but for democracy more generally. If you tell people that democratic governments cannot solve their problems, that they are not more powerful than economic trends, it shouldn't be surprising that they are willing to vote for parties that tell them, yeah, we will blow the whole system up if necessary. There has to be an alternative. And that alternative on the left has to be primarily an economic one. So this is, again, a quote by your current prime minister in the European Parliament. What sets democratic politics apart from populism is that it does not tap into people's fears, but instead gives them back hope in the future. Parties, particularly parties of the left, can't win on pessimism. They can't win on fear. That is the winning strategy of the populist right. The left has to be able to tell people that there is an alternative and that this alternative is better than what they are currently living through. Two quotes on the bottom, sorry here, perhaps they're difficult to see, retrospectively by Tony Blair. Sometimes it can seem as if politics had become a mere technocratic exercise, well or less well managed, but with no overriding moral purpose. Renzi, obviously Italian, former Italian prime minister, same type. We were almost technocrats. That was our mistake. There is nothing wrong with being a good policymaker. There is nothing wrong with wanting effective policy. But particularly in times of distress, particularly in times of rapid change, you simply cannot offer people technocratic tinkering with the system. They need to believe that governments matter, they need to believe democracy matters, and they need to believe there are alternatives. And those alternatives, again, have to come from the left. They have to come in the form of a better economic future, and they have to come in form of optimism to fight back the sort of pessimistic and fear-based vision that is currently peddled by populists. So thank you very much for listening. If anybody has any questions, I'm happy to take them. Yes. This gentleman here right in the front.
First of all, let me thank you for being here. It's always a pleasure to have such established intellectuals here in our little corner of Europe. I wanted to say that I do agree with you fully that economic strife and crisis usually leads to a rise in populist views. I would say even that our failures that you pointed out in the social issues are a weapon brought on as well by economics, because usually it's easier to blame the immigrants or the social issues for the lack of economic opportunities, when in reality those have other causes that aren't anything related to those social issues. I would like to have you comment on that as well. And also the globalization problem you spoke of. Globalization has some benefits. I think China is a huge case study of that, where millions have been lifted out of poverty just by a few, not even a complete democratization of free trade, but just some simple measures. However, it is true as well that the lion's share of these benefits seems to concentrate and create almost an oligopoly in some societies. What measures would you propose for us to implement as left politicians and so on that could make an impact in increasing the concentration of these benefits in so few and disperse them better societally? And I think in this case we need to be careful as well, because Trump, for example, is taking what is traditional. Trump is taking what is traditionally a left stance on public trade, which is imposing sanctions and so on, which I don't believe really benefits anyone or everyone at that. And finally, we do blame a lot of this crisis and its effects on globalization, but study after study shows that our stagnant wages and our incapability of having the same social progression, economic progression as before, is mostly due not to offshoring jobs, but mainly of automation. And if this shouldn't be a way bigger issue on the fight against the social disruption of populists, and if we shouldn't be more thoroughly committed to a machine tax, as people have been speaking of. Thank you very much.
Great. Thank you. So that's a lot of really good questions. Let me start with the first, which is in some level the most straightforward. Yes, obviously, one of the problems with economic crises is that they make scapegoating and looking for easy solutions quite easy, right? So when there are problems, it's very easy for politicians to point towards some evil enemy as the source of those. And oftentimes, especially with right-wing populist parties, that enemy tends to be, again, immigrants, because it's easy to kind of point to them. But there's very little evidence that immigrants are dramatically taking jobs or lowering wages, but they are there, and so they can be easily pointed to, which is one of the reasons why it's very important for the left to have an alternative narrative, not only about what's going on economically, but also to be forthright in addressing some of the concerns about immigration, because not talking about things doesn't make problems go away. So I think the left sort of faltered in both not having a good sort of set of alternative economic policies, but also in not addressing the immigration issue until it had essentially become dominated by discourses from the right. The second thing I think that's really important to stress is that it's not enough just for the left to advocate for redistribution. It also must have plans for increasing economic growth, because you can't redistribute more unless your economy is growing. And one of the things that's worrisome, as I see on parts of the left, even in my own country, is because of a dramatic, a resentment about things like rising inequality and disproportionate gains going to the wealthy, there is an incredible emphasis on, again, redistribution, all of which I think is healthy. But the problem is if that comes at the expense of also thinking about how to make sure economies grow, not only will you have less to redistribute, but you will also tend to create some of those more zero-sum conflicts that are so deadly for democracy. So something has to be done, particularly in parts of Europe where welfare states are so rigid and so unable to kind of promote labor market flexibility, something needs to be done about those welfare states. I mean, there's no doubt that the Italian system, for instance, has several problems, but the welfare or social policies in that country, I mean, one of the problems is that they are not actually designed to help people adjust to change. They are dramatically favoring insiders as opposed to outsiders. So in some places, actually, the welfare states that exist, not that they're doing more harm than good, but they're not doing as good as they should be. Last question about automation. Yes, there's actually more evidence that automation is potentially problematic than there is that immigration is, particularly over the long term. I'm not sure, again, if what we're experiencing today is dramatically different than in the past. I don't know what people's backgrounds here. Like, my grandfather was a typesetter. He set the type in newspapers. His job, as well as the entire union that represented him, disappeared because that no longer existed because of automation. Is it possible that we're going through something more than the traditional capitalism, everything that is solid melts into air? Maybe. I'm not sure of that. I think we're certainly going through changing times. I don't know if it's dramatically different from changes that have happened in the past. But what's important, right, is to make sure that more people are prepared for the jobs that do exist in the future. So there's lots of evidence that the best thing that can be done is to dramatically expand educational opportunities to make people both better suited for the jobs of the future and better suited to be able to switch among jobs, because the days when you would have one job for your whole life are really long gone. So there's, again, these are not easy problems, but I don't think they're necessarily problems that don't have solutions. Thank you. Yes.
Good afternoon. My first question is related to your historical presentation, because you didn't refer, but I think the consensus that you referred around social democratic policies in Europe after 1945, after the Second World War, I think it was a lot based in the existence of an alternative that was the communist model in Eastern Europe. And I think the change or the shift that you're also referring, that you said it was late 70s, early 80s, I would tend to say that was a bit later. It also happens related or correlated with the end of the communism in Eastern Europe. And I think capitalism gained a new strength with the end of the alternative model in the East. And I think that was an important cause for the shift toward liberal economics all over Europe and all over the world. And the other comment or the other question is related to the moments that we are living, and after the consensus that created the WTO without caring much about imposing social rules in the way of the agreements of the WTO would work. So you had a completely unfair competition all over the world between countries like Western European countries competing with countries in Asia that didn't have to worry about pollution the way we have. They didn't have to worry about the number of hours of work. They don't have to worry about which salaries they would have to pay. That unfair competition led us to the present situation. And in this present situation, like you even said in the answer to the previous questions, create these situations like in some countries in Europe where, as you said, something needs to be done about the welfare state, because, for instance, welfare state is not cheap. So how is it possible that the left parties or social democratic parties in Western Europe go back to their traditional ways of caring about the ones that are being left behind and so on, if at the same time the welfare state that we have needs to be changed?
Great. So I agree with you on your first point. So I think part of the reason why you got, why you got a consensus around that sort of social democratic compromise after 1945 was both the part that I stress, which is a recognition of again, the need to avoid the tragedies of the interwar years. But you are absolutely right that the presence of communism helped focus the attention, particularly of folks on the right, that social democracy was better than the alternative. And it also played a huge role, for instance, in the United States, being much more willing to support this kind of social democratic consensus in Europe, again, out of fear of communism. So I absolutely agree that that helped sort of, you know, sort of push people towards this compromise as clearly better than the alternative, which was communism. I also think that the collapse of communism is also important. Remember, you know, Reagan and Thatcher, they come before that, right? So that shift, that neoliberal shift started before the collapse of communism. But I agree with you, but I would stress the collapse of communism in perhaps a slightly different way, which is I think what it did is it created this sense of triumphalism. Capitalism has succeeded. And I also think it robbed people of a recognition of how fragile democracy actually is, right? So people emerging from the Second World War understood that democracy was very fragile and that it could only succeed under very certain conditions, right? If you just lived through the interwar period, you understood what extremism was. You understood how easy it was for extremists to gain support. And that was a historical memory that was very present. I think the collapse of communism sort of accelerated this historical amnesia and made everybody think capitalism is wonderful and never has problems, and democracy is the kind of natural form of government, so we don't have to worry so much about it. And I think that that accelerated, again, a lot of this embrace of neoliberal policies, not only because, again, of the capitalist triumphalism, but because I think people just forgot that deep inequalities, growing economic insecurity, that these things were really very politically dangerous. And so I agree with you on both of those points. As far as the government spending, look, there's no correlation whatsoever between growth, economic growth, and the amount of money governments spend. So if you do, you know, run a correlation, the governments that spend the most, whatever, they are not the ones that have the greatest economic problems. In fact, the correlation actually goes a little bit in the other way. It's how the government spend their money that is potentially problematic or progressive. So if you spend lots of money keeping people rigidly in particular positions, protecting insiders as opposed to outsiders, that welfare state spending is not as helpful as it could be. If you are spending a lot of money investing in education, investing in welfare state policies that facilitate, for instance, people moving around the country from one geographical area to another, retraining them from one industry to another, even though spending is quite high, that's not economically unviable. So the obvious counterpoint here is the difference between Scandinavian countries and places like Italy, right? They spend actually even more, but it's not a problem because they're spending the money differently. Now, I don't want to suggest that switching from an Italian system to a Swedish system can be done overnight. Oh, if we just realized how wonderful this was, we could do that. I mean, that is a very, very difficult thing to do. There's lots of institutional and political rigidities inherent in these systems. But the point is to make clear that it's not the spending that's problematic. It's not powerful, protective welfare states that are problematic. It's bad policies that are problematic. Again, that doesn't mean that everything would be easy, but it does mean there are alternatives. And there are alternatives that the left can build upon, I think, hopefully in the future. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your presentation. One quick question. When you refer to the historical process that led to the empowerment of social democratic parties in the late 19th century, I mean, and as your work, published work shows, there was always a part of the supremacy of the ascendancy process of these parties, which involved some form of coalition building, right? With all the parties which are not from the socialist family, so to speak, or are from the socialist family, like communists, but are not in the more liberal certainly the more liberal tradition. And so I would just like to know your opinion. What are the conditions that you, and this is particularly relevant for the present period mm-hmm. in Portugal also, because yep. we are in some form of coalition.
Yeah.
What are, and the coalitional politics is always also needed always in terms of having progressive governance. You see that also in many historical examples, even examples which were short-term, like the Popular Front in mm-hmm. France. I mean, there was still some positive legacy of the things they did that lasted up to after World War II. So in your opinion, what would be the conditions for favoring coalitions between the center and the left or progressive forces altogether and the conditions that inhibit it?
Thank you. Another great question. So I think today it is very important for the center-left to regain its distinctive economic profile. So the kind of coalition that you have today in Portugal, which is a left coalition, a coalition between a sort of center-left party and smaller, further-left parties, I think for right now, this is the kind of thing that other parties of the left in Europe need to be striving for, because the real issue for parties like the SPD or the Social Democrats in other countries is that they have lost a lot of their distinctive profile, particularly on economic issues. And I think it's very important for voters to see that there is a real difference between left and right on these issues. And the problem with grand coalitions at a time like that is voters don't see that. So the SPD in Germany, for instance, it's managed to put forward some of its policies, but voters are not very aware of what it is that the SPD stands for versus what it is that the CDU stands for, because it's in a grand coalition with the CDU at the head. And so it's hard to know what it is that the SPD is actually contributing. I think Popular Front governments were at a time when democracy was much more threatened than today. And so if you're dealing with a situation where you fear democratic collapse, then the key glue holding that coalition together is fighting for democracy. What's going on today, I think, is something different. I think what's going on today is a need for voters to see this is what the right stands for, this is what the left stands for. And so these kind of grand coalitions, I think, are very bad, not just for the left, but for democracy more generally. This fellow in the back here. Oh. So maybe we can take him and then we can go over here. He's back here. Yeah. Sorry, I just saw him first. No problem. I was looking in the wrong direction.
I will be brief. I'm actually working on an assignment on the rise of populism in Europe. And I realized that after reading a lot of books that talks about populism and the context of Europe, that all the background ideas you have given shows that when people actually dissatisfied with democratic principles, then populism seems to claim, so to say, to take up being that anti-elitism, becoming the voice of the people, what Rousseau may call the general will. However, but that it's a claim for me. At the end of it all, when the rich are the top of it, power, things seems to be normal. But if Europe must maintain its standard, I mean, of principles, of socialism and all that, values, I think there are policies that are needed to be looked upon. I seem to draw the line of a right gentleman who talks about the idea. I think the challenges are quite difficult if these things are not taken seriously, because the populist ideology seems to be at the top, looking at the statistic given basically on poverty, issues of migration and challenges of economy and social issues. I mean, we can talk about in the context of Portugal and other European countries. And of course, we are talking about the Brexit now in UK that also might affect some of these issues. My question is, what are the practical, you know, I've been listening to you for quite a while and I'm grateful, but what are the practical solutions to this problem? What can this party that I wish to belong to in the near future can look upon and say, well, these elections, we might or we must look at these 1, 2, 3, 4 key principles and see how we can take Europe back to where it belongs. Thank you.
Great. Well, these are very good and very difficult questions. If I had all the answers to those questions, probably I would, you know, not be standing here. But I let me speculate, because obviously your question is the sort of crucial one. It's a sort of what is the bottom line. So I will try to sort of speak broadly, because that's probably as best as I can do with my competence. So I would say there's two things, right, obviously, that need to be addressed, right? One is this, again, return to what I would consider to be sort of social democratic principles on economic policy, right? So there has to be an alternative, right? Austerity, policies that hurt the most disadvantaged, this is an anathema for the left. It cannot be there at all, right? So policies that not only promise to protect the most disadvantaged, but that promise, again, a society where everybody has the possibility to rise, where everybody has the possibility for new opportunities. This is obviously has to be the source of the left's message. Also, the left has to believe, right, that capitalism is not an evil system, right? Because if you believe that, then this whole social democratic compromise also breaks down. You have to have faith that democracy can deliver capitalism's upsides while protecting you from its downsides. If you don't believe that, if you're at heart a democratic socialist in the terms that I put it, then this whole thing won't work, because you're then fighting a zero-sum battle, and zero-sum battles are not good for democracy and they're not good for the left. So a focus on both growth and equality, I think, is really crucial. I'm not suggesting that's easy, but I'm suggesting that is the only way for this sort of social democratic, again, not in the Portuguese sense, but in the ideological sense, for that kind of economic policy to have a future for Europe and for citizens more generally. Social and cultural issues. These are issues, again, that I think are very dangerous for the left and democracy. But they're there, and the left cannot ignore them. Ignoring these issues has been a problem for too long. The left has to come and say, look, immigration is a positive good for our societies. We want to make it legal. We want to put in place policies that will help native citizens adjust, right? We are not going to make this a zero-sum game economically. And also policies that ensure that people who come to our country, whichever country it is, are not put at a disadvantage. They are integrated, figure it out for themselves, when they're often coming from incredibly different social, cultural, economic. Want immigration to work, that is something that governments have to work at. You can't just bring people in and then hope things are going to work out. Just that's not the way policies, that's not the way things go. So I think the left wants to focus its attention again on preparing, providing a distinctive. We believe immigration is good. We want to keep it legal. We want to keep it controlled. And we want to make it a positive sum game, both for citizens who have been here longer and for citizens who are coming in. I do not think that is an unachievable challenge, but I think it's one, again, that the left has ignored for too long, thinking that it was just somehow going to work out. And it's not. That's not the way the world works. Thank you. Sorry.
Thank you very much for your very comprehensive explanations. And I think we do all agree about the conclusions. I'm more concerned about the solutions, and because that's the problematic bit, let's say. And ahead of European elections, I have just two. I imagine you, well, as you may know, the framework of the European Parliament, until now, let's say, the Socialists and Democrats and EPP plus the Liberals would have with more than 60%, mm-hmm. this will be this will decrease significantly. Well, let's see about the polls. But regarding your identity crisis or the phenomenon of identity crisis, some people argue that as the Socialists and Democrats in the European Parliament should not, they will not have the lead, then they should try to be at least the lead of the progressive forces. So trying to have a coalition with the Greens, with the Liberals. Is, in your view, this a way to go, or actually another repetition, especially when we talk about the Liberals, a repetition of this identity crisis trap? And then, this is a question about the strategy, a question about the communication of the message. I truly believe on what you've just said about the importance of a talk with the people that feel invisible, that feel left behind. How do you think that actually socialist parties, or let's say the left or the center-left in Europe, can actually be more effective in speaking at these people, more effective than with a global message, with addressing global issues, more effective than the populist parties, actually, mm-hmm. and the populist movements. In a way, how can some people say that and the polls show that people perceive socialist movements as they get the content, but they cannot be concrete, or they cannot get concrete. So in a way, how can socialists how can we make socialism sexy again?
Okay, that is really, that may be way beyond my competence. So let me try to answer your first question and then your second question. Look, I think that the criteria these days for the left entering a coalition has to be, will that coalition allow them to pursue a clearly left-wing policy, right? So coalescing with Greens, that might be perfectly fine. I mean, what seems to me key, right, and from what I understand of the Portuguese case, right, is that these are parties that have important differences, but they agreed on needing to end austerity, right? So the joining the glue was, okay, look, we have lots of other differences, but these austerity policies, the disadvantaging of the already disadvantaged, this has to stop. So we will coalesce around a program, not that pretends we don't have other differences, but that is focused on this. That strikes me as where the left needs to be today, right? The problem may be that in other countries, the smaller left-wing parties may not be ready to make those kinds of compromises, right? But the main left, its criteria, I think, has to be, look, if we come to power in this coalition, will we be able to put forward a program, a set of policies that says to voters, this is what the left stands for. Not that there aren't other issues that the left may have and it disagrees on, but this is what the left stands for. I think, again, in retrospect, probably the SPD joining with the CDU, for instance, in Germany, was a mistake. I understand why they did it. It's a party with a very long history of wanting to defend democracy, but I think it's just probably at this point counterproductive. So I think that has to be the criteria today. Does it allow us to present ourselves as left in a way that voters can clearly identify? I think that's true at the European level as well. Look, I think again, and I'm going to partially reiterate what I said to the previous questioner. If you look at the constituencies for populist right-wing parties in much of Europe, it's disproportionately composed of working class voters and lower middle class voters, not only, but primarily. Those two groups actually have quite divergent economic interests often. Lower middle class voters are less enamored of high taxes and large welfare state expenditures than workers are. As long as, again, competition is focused on social and cultural issues, those groups will hold together because they're joined by this kind of nativist backlash kind of thing. They're less cohesive on economic issues. Again, the left is the exact opposite. It's more split on social and cultural issues. it's more potentially united on economic issues. I think, again, what the left needs to do is it needs to neutralize those immigration issues. In the United States, it's a little bit different because we have racial issues that are much more deeply seated. But in Europe, I think the problem was is that the new left kind of voices took over these parties and thought, okay, look, I'm a cosmopolitan elite living in New York or Lisbon. I travel, I go to university. I love everything about diversity because it's part of my life. I think the problem is that they didn't recognize that government policies needed to be put in place to help both immigrants and native citizens adjust to these things. They just thought it would all be fine. That was a mistake. And so they allowed this issue to become owned by the populist right. It must be neutralized by the left. Right? In other words, the left has to say, look, we will deal with these problems. We recognize that they exist, but we will integrate immigrants into the economy. We will integrate immigrants into the society. They will speak our language. They will not live in ghettos. We will make this all work. It will be a net plus, and then they need to move on. That's what needs to happen. Again, I'm not suggesting that that is easy, but that is the flip side of what has happened over the last couple of decades. And it's just, it's neither good for the left nor for democracy, I think. Thank you. It's fine with me. I'm sure other people want to go, but go ahead.
I didn't hear the beginning. I arrived a bit later, so I apologize for that. But my question goes exactly in line to your answer to the gentleman over there in the back, because it was very similar to what Nancy Pelosi answered a few years ago in a town hall debate. Mm-hmm. She was confronted by a young student that said that there was a recent Harvard study that pointed out that 54% of young people in the U.S. Were rejecting capitalism as a model. And you just said basically what she said, which is we are capitalists and we have to be part of that system. And my question is, as socialists and social democrats in Europe, why are we permanently and systematically for the last three decades condoning capitalism as a system? Because capitalism is based on a systematic lie, which is meritocracy. It doesn't work. And you see that even in Europe, for example, the countries that have the biggest limits to capitalism, which are the Nordic countries with their own model, are the ones where social mobility are the highest. Mm-hmm. And when they had liberal governments, this social mobility stagnated and even decreased. So the introduction of liberal measures in these countries that had very high social protection and that limited highly the capitalism were the ones that actually increased inequality. So why are we, as socialists and social democrats, still not proposing a change and getting out of this model as a whole, coming up with a different proposal? Not coming back to a communism model, I totally reject that as a whole, but why are we not putting forward a different economic model that actually is based on tackling what economy should be doing, which is the social part and tackling inequalities?
Well, again, it gets back perhaps to some of these sort of earlier debates within the socialist movement. Do you think that you can have capitalism's upsides, growth, innovation, whatever, however you want to think about that, and protect from its downsides, right? If you believe that you can have those things, then social democracy makes sense, right? Now, I think in the opposite way that you presented them, which is, I think that what there's very little nationalization, there's very little over-regulation of the economy, right? What there is very strong welfare states, although less strong than they were in the past, right? And they're welfare states of a very particular kind, right? Very high labor force participation rates, very low toleration for long-term unemployment. Everybody's supposed to work. So in that way, it's kind of a very, I don't know, materialist? Yeah.
About the nationalization, because yeah. There are still large sectors of the economy that are still highly nationalized. The pharmacies, for example, in Sweden were privatized a few years ago.
But what's brought into the public sector in Scandinavia and in Sweden in particular are social services, right? Not the business sector, right? So yes, healthcare is of course completely a national thing, Although, again, it has been more privatized, unfortunately, as has education, interestingly enough, in the last years under liberal governments, which has been a real problem, actually, in Scandinavia, both politically and economically. But the things that are brought into the public sector were social services, not businesses. So we're not, France, for instance, and Italy always had much larger nationalized business sectors than the Scandinavian countries did. But that strikes me as, again, what sort of social democracy is, right? Which is, it's a capitalist economy, right, with sort of social, the government committed to whatever level of social protection is necessary to keep people's lives, their ability to move from poverty to middle class or upper middle class or whatever, that the resources that are necessary for those kinds of things, that's what the state provides. But it doesn't interfere otherwise more than necessary in the sort of market or the economy. That strikes me as the kind of sweet spot, so to speak, for social democracy. Now, again, if you believe that that system can't work over the long term, then you're basically, as I think you were pointing towards, left with two alternatives. One is, you try to get rid of capitalism. I'm just not sure what the alternative would be. I'm not sure I'd want to live in a world where the state controlled more of the economy. I think that's an inherent threat to freedom and democracy, but maybe somebody has a better alternative. And I just want to end with one thing. If you ask young people in the United States what they think about capitalism, and they say, oh, we're negative. And then you ask them, well, what does that mean? They don't have any idea, because we have no socialist tradition in the United States. Most of them really want something that looks like that Swedish system. They want more social protection. They want free healthcare. They want free education. They want all kinds of things that people in Europe take for granted that we've never had in the United States. But they don't really have a clear economic alternative to capitalism. What they want is not to have their life chances determined entirely by, again, what kind of job they get. Because that is an inherently risky, dangerous, and uncomfortable position. And that's where I think social democrats are, right? Which is, they're saying, look, we believe that markets and capitalism can be good, but we want to make sure that you're protected from, again, the dislocation, the risk, and the downsides of those things. Anyway, thank you for the question, and thank you all.